Good afternoon. Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Steve Wald, and it's my pleasure to welcome all of you to today's talk. This is the final lecture in our anniversary lecture series. The Prairie Research Institute, as you know, is made up of the five scientific surveys and is one of the largest institutes at the University of Illinois. Institute scientists provide research, information, and data on Illinois' natural and cultural resources to protect and enrich the state's economy, environment, and people. As part of our mission, and with the generous support of the donors listed in your program, the Institute has hosted an annual lecture series since our inception in 2008. But to mark our fifth anniversary this year, we've offered three lectures. Jack White last October in this room, Scott Tinker in December, and finally this afternoon's talk delivered by the Institute's founding executive director, Bill Shilts. I've had the pleasure, it's been a pleasure to work with Bill for nearly 8 years. He's the first geologist that I really had a chance to get to know, and he's helped me discover that geologists think and see differently than most people. And I've come to understand it's because they think and see in four dimensions. I experience reality most of the time in two dimensions, left and right, forward, backward, and right now. Terra firma is what my feet touch, plus or minus a garden spade. But geologists think and see all the way down. And you may have noticed in the ads or the flyer for this lecture that none of it is a surprisingly close analog to Champaign County 19,000 years ago. 19,000 years ago. That counts as current events to a geologist. It's the equivalent of discussing the morning paper over afternoon coffee. And 19,000 years ago, not 20,000 years ago, that 1,000 years represents laser precision to a geologist. I understand Bill took his first job with the Vermont Geological Survey 50 years ago this June, and he spent his entire career as a scientist and a leader of scientists in the public service, where he's been able to apply his expertise to make innovative and substantial contributions in the worlds of science and policy for the benefit of and the safety and the prosperity of people. Bill's leadership of the Institute has been foundational and steadfast. And please join me in welcoming Dr. Bill Shilts.
Thanks, Steve. I'll have to say that this is Steve's last official duty. This is his last day with the Institute. He's joining our friend in extension, George Sparr, sitting back there as his director of communications or coordinator of communications. I'm not sure what the title is. And I really appreciate, he's sort of organized these lectures over the years. And I'm used to introducing the speaker, but today I'm going one step farther. I'd like to also recognize Edmund Thornton, who came all the way down from Ottawa, the Illinois Ottawa, today to join us. Ed shares, and I think there's some others in the audience who I've met and probably others, shares some of this experience because when he was an undergraduate, he was involved in a geographical expedition to Violet Island, Northern Baffin Island, the Pond Inlet area, at a time when it was even more primitive than it is now. And so he has seen great changes up there too, and I'm really appreciate you joining us today, Edmund. I wasn't quite sure how to start this, but that's me. I can't remember how old I was when that picture was taken, probably mid-40s, I'm guessing. But that boulder is in the backyard of my parents' place, the place that I moved to when I was about 6 years old, and where I grew up in northeastern Ohio. It's a piece of granitic gneiss that was carried from the Canadian Shield. I remember when I was 7 or 8 years old, my mother explaining to me that glaciers carried that boulder to Ohio from Canada. And I was very impressed by that, and I was so impressed by that I built a whole career on it eventually. Although that really wasn't what I started out to do when I went to university, but I naturally gravitated that way. And a lot of my career has been, was originally built on trying to figure out how glaciers move material around, especially as an aid to developing strategies for mineral exploration. I'm going to start out, I have a lot of slides to go through, and I'm going to try to rip through a lot of them fairly fast, but I'm going to focus on some. But I put together, I was driving, doing an errand last night, and I was thinking about how to start this out, and I guess what I tried to do, and I could go on with hundreds of these items that I'm going to talk about, but after growing up in northeastern Ohio, and with more than 25 years of formal education, what did I not know in 1970 when I first went to Nunavut? It wasn't called Nunavut then, it was called the District of Keewatin, where I was. And it's kind of like a top 10, but I'm just going to list some of them, and I could go on with lots of more. First of all, what is permafrost and what is patterned ground? That's something that you normally don't encounter in growing up in the type of environment that we grow up in central Illinois and Ohio or wherever you come from in the States. How do you choose an Arctic campsite for 10 people? There's nothing there. There's no people. There's no infrastructure. There's just a lot of tundra, a lot of lakes. And I sort of did that on the fly. Most of these things I had to learn on the fly because I certainly wasn't prepared for them. How do you use a radio to communicate? These were pretty primitive radios back then. You had to have crystals that matched other people's crystals to be able to talk to them at their frequency, and that didn't always work well. How do you move 30 tons of stuff that's been dumped on a runway on the coast of Hudson Bay 200 miles inland where there's nothing? How do you do that? And you actually, if you were watching the loop before, you saw part of that. And I'll show you a little bit later on. How many gallons does a Bell Jet Ranger or any other helicopter burn per hour? How many gallons, imperial gallons, does it burn per hour? A Jet Ranger burns about 22.5 per hour, and that really influences what you do, where you do it, how fast you can do it, and you don't want to run out of gas. How do you sample in an environment like that? What kind of strategy to use? I'll cover that a little bit. How do you manage and feed 10 people that are totally cut off from the civilized world? Totally on your own. There's nobody to call to bring food to you or anything. You gotta make sure you got food or you've got something set up, some sort of logistics set up to fly food to your camp. And the source of food is 250 miles away. So, and the only way to be brought in there is by calling somebody on the radio, which I didn't know how to use very well, and having somebody fly it in. How do you break up and set up a large camp? A large camp, I'm talking about 10 people. You don't just fly it in one shot and fly it out in one shot. You fly it, it took us 13 loads to get the first camp in, big plane loads. And you got to make sure when you've got people in the field, you've got to make sure that they've got something to survive on because you don't know what the weather's going to be like. That plane may not be able to come back. You can't just sort of throw stuff on it and hope for the best. How do you deal with cooks that go bonkers on you? I had two the first year I was there, one of whom was standing outside the tent yelling at all the other guys in the tent. I was out, I was on the radio, had a knife, and he was throwing it back and forth and screaming at the guys in the tent. There's nobody to go to. You can't call 911. How do you deal with dangerous animals? There are a lot of pretty dangerous animals up there, particularly barren land grizzlies, which I was assured wasn't a real species. It didn't really exist, but I can guarantee you they do, and they can run 40 miles an hour across the tundra. I found that out by having to chase them away from samplers where we inadvertently dropped them right next to one. How do you weather storms? How do you deal with 24-hour daylight? The first summer I was up there, I was awake all the time. I never got tired because the sun never went down. How do you stay warm? The first summer I was there, it was lots of cold, rainy weather, not unlike today. Cold, a little colder than today, probably in the lower 40s. And then one summer I was up there, the temperature was in the 90s, and it never goes down below 85 or so because the sun never goes down. It's light all the time, and the way we stayed cool is we just put our jeans and sweatshirts on, walked into the lake, and walked around wet all the time because the evaporation keep you cool. There's no way to get out of the sun. There are no trees or anything. And you have to understand all of us, when we go across the street out here, there's probably 10 people that have made that safe. We don't ever see them or think about them, but they're there making sure that we're not run over, or we have traffic control or whatever. And it's really hard for somebody who's grown up in this environment to be up there and realize if you just wander away from camp, take a walk some night, sprain an ankle, you might never be found again. It's really easy to lose people up there. It's really hard to find them, even when they've got day glow clothes on. And finally, the 15th most important thing you have to learn to do when you're up there is build a bathroom. I don't have a picture of it, but I do have a really nice picture of a Mark II that we built the second year we were up there. It's basically a 55-gallon drum, or a 45-gallon drum sunk into the ground with a seat we kind of fashioned in the field. But you don't realize until you got 10 people wandering around a campsite and you're going to be there for 2 months, you've got to do something pretty basic to make sure that you don't poison yourself, among other problems. So these are all issues that I had to deal with. And when I was sitting on that rock and thinking about the reason that picture was taken is because by that time in my life, I was a geologist. I had been studying how glaciers move dirt around, and I had been working in the Arctic. But it's a long way from Akron, Ohio, where I was born, to the central part of Nunavut, and then later on, the northern part of Nunavut. So I'm going to go through a bunch of slides now. Any of you came in early saw some of the video, that some of that really shaky video at the beginning was Super 8 movies that I took years ago with no sound, and they didn't transfer very well to videotape or DVD, but that's why it was. Nunavut is that area. Actually, that map, which is I think a Canadian government map, is wrong, because that island there on the right side of Hudson Strait is part of Nunavut. They, for some reason, left it off. It's all the islands in Hudson Bay are part of Nunavut. Nunavut is about a quarter of the size of the United States. Land area is about a quarter of the size of the United States. Has a total population now of right around 33,000 people. It's not very populated, and most of those people are in little hamlets along the coast. There are probably six or seven hamlets that have between 1,500 and 6,000 people living there. So it's not like they're distributed everywhere. There is nothing in the interior. So no towns, just no infrastructure at the moment. I just put this up to show you the Canadian Shield. This sort of pink and yellow and brown rock is very granitic. It's the core of North America. Every continent has a core like this, a Precambrian, very old rocks. It tends to be very granitoid, I guess would be the word, very granitic, and so the soils are very acid. There's very little lime in the soils there. The blue areas the blue areas on that map are places where there's a lot of limestone, and so the vegetation is very, very different. This is the area that was glaciated by the last continental glacier. The white areas are the all-time glaciation. The blue is the last major glaciation. The red dots, the two big red dots up north, are where I'm mostly going to be talking about. The other dots are places I've worked in Canada extensively. And of course, the big dot at the bottom is us, where we're sitting today, approximately almost at the edge of that last glaciation. The significance of this is you read a lot in the news about the carbon reservoir in the Arctic and how melting permafrost is going to release carbon. That glacier stripped, there is no carbon reservoir there. There is in Siberia, where there wasn't any glaciation, and there is, you can see the gray area up in Alaska. That was never glaciated, so there's a lot of carbon there. But for the most part, in North America, there's no carbon reservoir to speak of. It looks pretty much like that in the tundra. It's just rocks and glacial sediments, glacial till. And of course, down here, it's not as rocky, but it's basically the same sort of materials. The area around Hudson Bay, because of the weight of that glacier, the crust was pushed down into the mantle. And after as the glaciers melted away, the mantle flowed back in under the crust, and gradually lifted the crust back up. So at the maximum, Hudson Bay looked like that blue area after the last glaciation. The area that I worked in was all in this area here, and most of it was below sea level at one point, anywhere from a couple thousand to 6,000 years ago. And how that manifests itself is these incredible beaches that's on one of the islands out in the mouth of Hudson Bay. They're just at higher and higher levels. The entire island is covered with beaches like this. There's another shot of them. You can see them climbing there up the slope. And it's still raising, you can see. The main feature that I had to deal with up there, and most people who grow up in an area like this are not very prepared to deal with, is permafrost. That area that on the map with the horizontal bars, that's the area of continuous permafrost. Permafrost, which means that every year, anywhere from a meter and a half to 25 centimeters thaws, that's the active layer, and everything else is frozen down to over 1,000 feet, even in the south part of that band. South of there is discontinuous permafrost, and whether there's permafrost or not depends on what the soil characteristics are. Permafrost means it's just a contraction of permanent frost. It means that the ground never thaws. That the surface does, but the ground underneath never thaws. And it is most developed at about -8 degrees Celsius, where it's continuous. So this is really important. I don't like putting up slides with writing on them, but this is important to understand. Permafrost and the active layer. The active layer is the seasonally thawed layer. When you read about warming climate and issues associated with that, people are really talking about the active layer. This first got studied extensively when the Alaska Alcan Highway was being built during the Second World War, and they tried to put a road through continuous and discontinuous permafrost. And if you remove material from the surface, the frost table just goes down. It stays at a constant depth in the summer. I mean, this is the surface permafrost table. But what really controls permafrost is there's constant heat coming from the center of the Earth, the geothermal heat gradient, and what controls how thick the permafrost is and how it degrades is how the battle between the cold in the ground that comes from the atmosphere and the heat that's coming from the bottom works. Where I've worked, I can't imagine that the situation at the surface is going to be any different, even if you raise the temperature 10 degrees Celsius. It's not going to be any different. Eventually, the geothermal heat, because you're taking more heat out of the ground than now, eventually the geothermal heat will melt the bottom until it gets to the surface. That map of the glacial map of North America, those glaciers brought the permafrost table right to the surface because they're a great insulator and they're melted at the bottom. So that permafrost has only developed since those glaciers melted away. In Siberia, it's really, really deep because there was never any glaciation there to melt it. So why were we there in Nunavut? It wasn't just a lark. Jack Dempsey was telling me it looked like I was having a vacation, but there was a reason. There was a reason we were up there, several reasons we were up there. The first reason was I was given the equivalent today of $1 million. I was 29 years old. They just gave it to me and said, develop methods of doing mineral exploration in a remote area, because there's a lot of mineral potential in this area that I was in. Particularly gold and base metals and uranium and diamonds now. So we were up using helicopters to do sampling grids, and this was a sampling site. The other reason we're up in the very northern part of Nunavut around Bylot Island, this is a satellite image from the probably early to late 70s, was because Lancaster Sound is another name for it is the Northwest Passage, and up until recently it's been pretty ice choked because of little ice ages. It's had a lot of ice, but you can see on this image from the summer it's pretty free at its eastern end. A U.S. company back in I think it was around 1980 wanted to prove that the oil and gas supplies from the Central Arctic Islands could be shipped out through there with ice breaking tankers, and so they ran a tanker named the Manhattan through the ice and out the Northwest Passage down to Newfoundland. By the time it got to Newfoundland, it was a double-hulled tanker, and the outside of it had just been ripped to shreds, so they never tried it again. It just was not possible. But with warming up there, this is probably going to be open. And the reason we were mapping was because there's a lot of concern about spills on these coastal areas. And in fact, that island, Violet Island, was the subject of a PhD thesis at the University of Illinois. Rod Clausen mapped the glacial history and glacial geology of Violet Island back in the early 80s. This was my first day in the tundra. It was St. Patrick's Day, 1970, 40 degrees below zero and a 40 mile an hour wind. It was nasty. And a few months later, this is what it looked like. I picked that campsite, and I knew nothing about picking campsites. I mentioned that earlier. This was a fantastic campsite. And it turns out when we poked around a little bit, we could see Inuit had been using this site for a long time also. There's stone rings down there in the lower area. But this gives you an idea of the logistics of setting up a camp like that. I remember specifically these little barrels. They're 10 imperial gallon barrels. They weigh about 80 pounds a piece. We had 300 of those. We had 75 of the bigger barrels, which are 45 imperial gallon barrels, 450 pounds a piece. We loaded everything by hand into a World War II patrol bomber, a PBY Canso. They call them in Canada. They're Catalinas here. And you have not lived until you have lifted, without any mechanical aid, a full-size household refrigerator through that back turret. It's possible, but I wouldn't want to do it again. You have to build a nest of barrels to do that. The way we got around up there, this was the most exotic way. I had the CGS Pierre Addison. It was a brand new icebreaker, Canadian Coast Guard icebreaker. They have to hang around up there in the early season anyway, because looking for before the shipping season starts. And so I rode them, and they gave me this boat for 2 weeks. 65 crew. It was like living in a nice hotel on the middle of Hudson Bay. And we used that to map. There's a helicopter on it. We used that to map the two big islands in the mouth of Hudson Bay. We used smaller boats on the lakes, of course, and we did a lot of work on sampling the lakes, and you'll see some more about the lakes later on. And we also did sonar work on the lakes, which is what this gear is here, sub-bottom acoustic profiling. And we were one of the first people to use ATVs in North America. We first used them in 1971. These are Honda tricycles, extremely dangerous, and really not very good in that kind of country. That's as tall as the trees get there. Those are willow trees, and they don't. That's actually a maximum height that you see. And we used, of course, helicopters. That's basically the way we were able to work up there, and why this was fairly groundbreaking, because those helicopters had just become reliable enough to be safe to use on large-scale operations like this. This is a Bell 47 G4 hauling ATV around. This is a Bell 47 G2. The 47 stands for 1947. That's when those helicopters became operational, and we were using them in 1970. You can't land one with floats when the float's flat. And I'm not going to tell you how to do it, because it's very it's very dangerous, but they were doing it there. There's a way to do it. These are one of these things, it's not always successful. And eventually we went, in the later years, we went to Jet Rangers, which is a turbo-powered helicopter, very, very much faster and much more reliable, and carry more people. We could carry three samplers and a navigator and a pilot, as we just went across the tundra digging holes in lines. We'd lay them out, and that's what we do. And then getting out of the field, this was coming out of the field, I think in 1973, in a Twin Otter. It's a twin turboprop airplane with floats on it. We never got above 500 feet because the pilot was afraid if we went up in the clouds, we wouldn't be able to get back down again. And so at one point I looked out the window and I saw caribou running alongside of us. So we'll go first up to Violet Island, which one of the reasons for going there, I had personal reasons besides the issue of coastal contamination by potential oil-carrying boats. I was very interested in Violet Island because it's like a miniature Canada. It's got a Precambrian core, like you saw on the map of the geology of Canada, these really old crystalline rocks, and then it's got progressively younger rocks around the outside, just like a miniature North America. And so I was really interested in how these glaciers, you see a couple of them there coming down to the sea, how these glaciers picked up debris and carried them, and I had a couple of students doing theses on that. That's now a national park, by the way, Sirmilik National Park. I took this picture, and I did, for reasons I don't understand, because I had no intention of ever being in Illinois again, but when I took this, for some reason, I remember thinking this is what the glaciers going across the prairies must have looked like in Illinois. And I was sending students down here, so it wasn't like I didn't have a connection, but it just struck me that way. This is an important one to understand some of the issues that we face in Illinois with the glacial deposits we have, because this is a retreating. Most of the glaciers on Violet are retreating. This is a glacier that's retreating, and if you look closely, you can see here's a large lake that's ice covered. Here's some smaller lakes that are kettles. Here's a river carrying coarse gravel outwash. Here's some alluvial fans. Here's a moraine. All these things are common around the edge of a glacier. Very complicated environment. Every square inch of Illinois had something like this pass across it. Every square inch that was glaciated. And it happened 3 or 4 times. So you can imagine drilling through 50 or 60 feet of the last glacial deposits and running into, say, lake sediments. How do you interpret that? You drill another hole over here and there's no lake sediments. And that is the conundrum in Illinois when you try to deal with groundwater issues and subsurface issues, is trying to visualize the complicated environments related to that glacial retreat, not to mention what happens after the glaciers retreat and the post-glacial processes take place. This, I should have put a label on here, this is a professional geologist, don't try this at home. This was one of the stupider things I ever did, is crawling under this glacier with these big boulders hanging out of the top of it, because you can see they fall down quite often. But the bottom of the glaciers is really charged with debris, and the top, most of the glaciers are just ice without much debris in them, even the glaciers here. But what happens eventually, as the glaciers retreat, often ice is stranded behind, and it doesn't melt very fast because the dirt that forms on top of it, just like the active layer in permafrost, keeps the ice from melting. There are places in Alaska, where the Bering Glacier in particular, where there are chunks of glacier that are probably 10 miles across and 25 miles wide that have been there for over 100 years, and they're just dirt all over the surface of trees growing on them. But that insulation keeps the ice from melting. Eventually, if it does melt, and it does when you have water that cuts channels like this, you get this deposit here, which is called glacial till, and that's what sort of the foundation is under all of Illinois, is we're underlain by glacial till. There's a lot of windblown dust at the surface, but that's what's under us. These two, this is the original air photographs that were taken systematically by the Canadian government back in 1948. They're called trimetragon photos because they couldn't afford to take vertical photos. They took photos at angles. Those two glaciers are ones that I worked on a lot. They are the one on the, let's go back here. The upper one there is Actinac Glacier. This is the edge where it was in 1948. Now it's about a kilometer back from there. And that's as far as that glacier has been advanced in 8,000 years. So it's not surprising that it's retreating. And we can tell that because in this windblown sand here, it hasn't been disturbed by the glacier, and it's got organic sediments in it. We radiocarbon dated it over 8,000 years. So it's as far as advanced as it's been in the last 8,000 years. Here's a boulder using cosmogenic dating, which is a beryllium 10, as I can't tell you what the chemistry is, but it's created by cosmic ray bombardment of siliceous minerals like quartz. And the amount of it is proportional to how old a surface is or rock is. And we were looking for boulders that looked like they had been not rolled over or anything. And the date on that boulder is roughly 55,000 years. And it's right out in front of those glaciers too. So through the last major glaciation in Illinois, which culminated 20,000 years ago, these glaciers up on Violet Island, way up north, were chugging along pretty much as they are today. They haven't really changed very much. and going, you know, they shrink periodically and advance periodically. And there's a good example. In 1948, this glacier here was out here, and it shrunk back well over a kilometer. On the other hand, that glacier there is hardly doing anything. Why is that? Well, it's partially because of what falls on the surface or what's on the surface. You can see the insulating properties of the rock. It's preserving glacier ice beneath it. This is fairly common to see these pedestals. But heat comes in, a lot of heat, and really exaggerates the melting of the ice surface around it. There's stuff that I had never suspected this. This is an algae that grows on the, up here. It's a circular algae. I've got the name of it here, but I can't pronounce it anyway, so I'll tell you what it is. If you want to know, I'll show it to you. But it grows on the glaciers in these little circular patches. They are less than a millimeter thick, and they suck in the heat because they're dark, and they just drill down into the ice. So they're generally about that far down in the ice, between 5 and 10 centimeters. So the more of that stuff there is, the more rapid the melting. Pebbles on the surface, even small pebbles like these, do the same thing. Anything that's dark on the surface creates a lot of melting, and the more of that stuff there is on the surface, the more that glacier surface is going to melt. Usually, you often see these pictures of the nice blue color of the glacier with surface water draining, and that's a typical summer scene. What you don't see usually is that most of the drainage and most of the melting of these glaciers is at the bottom. And as I said, most of the dirt of the glaciers is at the bottom, so water that's coming out of the bottom is very dirty and muddy, like this water is here. The thing about these rivers that are coming out of the glaciers is that they move around because they're obviously above freezing. They tend to thermally erode the sides of the channels that they're flowing in, and they move from year to year. They're rarely in the same place from one year to the other. And I've been back to this particular site a couple of years after I took these pictures, and there's just a big gravel deposit there, which was being deposited at the time this water was flowing out. And here is a glacier, the one that I showed you earlier that had retreated next to the one that hadn't retreated. This is a ridge of gravel that is melting out of the front that was formed in one of those tunnels. It's called an esker. And eskers are a very common part of Canada, south of, on the shield, south of Baffin Island. So now we're going to go back down south where I started my work on the tundra. And I said the reason we were up there was to try to develop methods of doing mineral exploration in remote areas. One of the first things I figured out was that I almost had to start from scratch trying to understand the landscape. You have to understand the landscape to develop strategies, number one, to do the sampling, and number two, to interpret what you see. So the first thing you see when you fly around up there is there's really very different types of terrain. You get, this is often what you see when you see books about permafrost. You see these polygonal patterns. That's a grass sedge meadow. But probably the most common pattern are these little circular features. They were called when I was up there frost boils. They have various names, not very well understood, partially because a lot of studies have been done, very detailed studies have been done on them, but in specific places. So somebody writing a major paper on these things may have dug up or studied 20 or 30 of these. We dug up over 20,000 of them. And so we have a lot better idea of what the processes are and how they're distributed in that environment. So the first thing to do was to figure out what to sample. There's another example that is sort of a drumlin as a streamlined hill formed by the glaciers, probably draped over with marine mud because this, as I said earlier, is below the level of marine submergence. And you can see around it are the frost cracked, is the frost cracked terrain. Well, let's look at the frost cracked terrain first. Under each of those cracks, there is a frozen surface, and in these grass sedge meadows, I don't know if you can see it, but right there is a hunting knife. That's in a summer where the temperature was in the 90s, a good part of the summer, and that's how much that thawed, less than 25 centimeters, because that organic material is a really good insulator. And that's when you talk about carbon storage in the Arctic, that's the kind of material they're talking about. This is very thin compared to the thick deposits in Siberia and Alaska, but it behaves the same way. It's not going to ever melt from the surface, even if you heat things up a lot, because of the insulating properties of the material. But you also find frost cracks on deposits like this, which are big deposits of sand and gravel. So what's common between those two? Well, in the case of the grass edge meadow, everything's frozen right up to the surface, so it's basically pretty stable. In the winter, the ground shrinks and creates cracks, polygonal cracks, just like you see in muddy areas when it's like the desiccation cracks you see in mud puddles and that sort of thing. And the same thing, it happens on all the terrains, but in sand and gravel, there's no water in it, so the cracks stay open in the spring. And the same with that highly frozen peat that's underneath the grass sedge meadow. That stays open, and underneath each of those is an ice wedge. So what happens is, in the winter, those cracks form, there's an open wedge, an open area. In the spring, as the spring melt takes place, water runs down, and because it's frozen a meter down below the surface, it freezes and keeps the crack open. So year after year, it gets wider and wider until it reaches a stable width. And that's how you get that. Basically, when you see that frost crack pattern, you can tell right away what the conditions are that you're looking at. And when we look at Illinois, that's an air photo from central Illinois. This is an air photo about the same scale from west of Hudson Bay. And it's not too hard to see the comparison of the patterns. We had the same frost crack patterns here. And probably we had the same patterns here because we have a layer of dust, a layer of luss that's a meter or so thick, and thicker in some places, that is very undeformable because it drains just like sand and gravel does. Then we have these areas with these circular patterns, which we call mud boils. I call mud boils. And how do they form? What are they? Well, they're in the active layer, the seasonally thawed layer, that thaws to an average depth of about a meter and a half. And that material, much of the material in the part of Keewatin that I worked in, is very fluid. And you can see this whole slope of mud boils is flowing down over pretty stable frost-cracked raised beaches. We actually dug some of these things up to see what it looked like beneath the surface, and believe me, it's not easy. You can see that the center of the mud boils is where the bare soil is, conducts heat much better than the organic surroundings. And so what you see underneath there is like a gigantic golf ball that mirrors the surface circular patterns. And this is actually the way we discovered this and were able to work this out, was there's a surface of red till with this red material deposit directly by the ice. It covers a lot of that area coming from some red rocks. And when you dig holes in those mud boils where the red till is, you can see that it's like a little volcano of red material that has been fluid and has come to the surface. It's a phenomenon that takes place during the summer when things are melting. And it's been described in Russian literature in particular as having something to do with frost. And although frost does play a role in moving rocks around, that's not what causes these circular features, at least in the southern part of the tundra. Atterberg limits, another instructional slide. Atterberg limits are something I didn't understand when I first started measuring them in my lab, but I eventually figured them out. And basically, they're engineering terms, civil engineering, a very simple measurement where you take a soil sample, add water to it, and at some point, a dry, solid soil will start to, you can mold it, becomes plastic. As you keep adding water, it gets more and more plastic, and eventually it goes over the liquid limit, and it loses all strength, becomes a liquid. And the difference, in this is weight percent by water, by the way, the numbers, the difference between the two is called the plasticity index. The plasticity index of these soils in southern Keewatin or southern Nunavut is very narrow. In fact, the liquid limit and plastic limit are almost the same. And you can jump up and down on one of these mud boils, and it's like cement. And about the fifth or sixth time you jump on it, the weight of your weight presses down, creates a pore water pressure that turns it to a liquid. And you just go right in, and I caught my helicopter pilot bouncing the helicopter on one of these things one day, and I said, stop it, I don't want you sinking into one of these things. I don't know what he was doing. He was 18 years old at the time. Anyway, so that's a feature that's very important to understand. I guess the best way to understand it is if my two hands are sand grains, say, and when the sediment is dry, they're locked together like that. If you keep adding, there's a lot of silt in the that is wrapped around, and clay wrapped around the sand grains. As you keep adding water, eventually that silt expands, and at some point, they're not in contact anymore, and there's no strength. And that's basically what happens. And what the results of that are something like this. That 10-gallon barrel there, I know when it was put out because it has a guy's name on it. It was a Geological Survey of Canada scientist. It was about 5 years after he put it out. One of those barrels, they were set at the same time. One of them was set on a stable part of a mud boil on the edge. One was set on that bare middle, and only weighed about 10 pounds. I mean, it's a barrel that big around and 10 pounds, so there's not much pressure per square centimeter, per square inch on the bottom, and yet it just sank. A much more disturbing event happened with Aaron Villakazi, who's a student of mine from Swaziland. And we were probing permafrost depths at the edge of lakes. And I'd been out snorkeling with another guy, another scientist from USGS. And he was busy doing this. And I just took this picture when he had done the last measurement down to permafrost. And I said, well, pull the thing out and we'll go. And you can see it's not very deep. The water's about that deep. Well, a little bit later, his one foot got in that bear patch and he couldn't get it out. And I half-heartedly tried to drag him out, and it wasn't working. And after about 2 hours, this is what happened. He was right down to the permafrost table. And what happened was that we're on an island in a lake, in a lake about half the size or a third the size of Lake Ontario. There was no way to get anybody there, any way to get him out. And this is where I say that you have to figure out how to, on the fly, how to do things yourself. Every time they would try to dig something up out because it was underwater, would just flow right back in and lock. So his foot, at the bottom of his foot, he had a leather boot on. It was driving the soil above the liquid limit, turning it to liquid. It would go down. As soon as it would go down, it locked right back to a solid again. So it just locked him as he went down. His one foot was completely out. It was just the one foot was in there. And he went right down to the permafrost table. And the way we got him out, fortunately, we had the helicopter with us, and we flew back to camp, and we had one of these portable firefighting pumps that we were using to move water around and to cut sections. And we brought it out and ended up blasting him out. But if we hadn't had that pump, that's a management decision I wouldn't have to make. I don't have to make decisions like that anymore. Another thing that we didn't know much about is fire. I was told that there's not enough biomass in the tundra to maintain tundra fires. And we saw a lot of smoke a couple of times in some of those early, if you saw the early movies, the helicopter flying around that looked a little bit hazy. That was smoke, and I assumed it was coming from a forest fire out in Western Canada somewhere. But in fact, it was probably coming locally. This is one of several fires that started in early August on that very hot summer. There was a thunderstorm, which is rare up there, and after that thunderstorm, there were fires all over the horizon, columns like this. That's mostly steam. And around those mud boils with the turf around the outside, they're just slowly burning around the edge of it. After the fire went by, you can see they burned out all the turf around the edges of the mud boils. You start out with a mud boil surface like this, not a very good picture, but you can see the circular turf around the individual mud boils, which are about 2 meters across, by the way. And after a year, this is a year later, or a couple years later, when the fires burn that turf away, you just have these rings of boulders. And if you look in the literature, there are two types. Mud boils are described in some literature as sorted circles and non-sorted circles. Sorted circles are the ones with turf. Non-sorted circles are the ones that are surrounded by boulders, as if there's some different process. But in fact, in most cases, I don't think there's a different process. I think it's just either the till is very bouldery to start out with, or we've had a fire event like this that's burned the turf away and created these circles. When I tell you these things, nobody really knew a lot of what I'm telling you at the time, and in fact, a lot of people still don't. It depends on what I've published and what people read, because it's very, very rare that somebody has the resources to fly around in a helicopter and see these kind of things and make these sorts of observations. Lots of people fly around up there, but they're going from point A to point B to do sampling for a mineral company or something like that. And from once we worked out the relationship between the soils and the patterns, this pattern ground related to the thawing of the permafrost in the active layer, we were able, using a satellite imagery, to do some pretty detailed maps of material types. But I really showed this because to show that there's a lot of lakes there, and I've always been fascinated by lakes. One of the things that we were doing early on was sampling the water in the lakes in Kaminak Lake. And we were camped right about in here, and right in here, the size of the bubbles there is related to the amount of mercury in the water. And it's just natural. It's obviously not coming out of the air, or the whole lake would look like that. A commercial fishery, the first one in the territories, was set up right there, and they never sold a fish because the fish were running, some of them, in the park pavilion mercury. And they moved the fishery about 15 miles away to Kaminak Lake, and they didn't have any problem at all. But it's just an example of how something you never would suspect, that's a natural pattern, can influence the economic decisions that people make. In the winter, lakes freeze, and when the water levels are low, it's a pretty arid area. It gets less than 20 centimeters a year average precipitation. And in the spring, when the spring melt comes, the ice is about 2 meters thick on average in here, and it's basically cemented to the bottom wherever the water depths are less than 2 meters. And so when the spring melt comes, you can see that often the centers of the lakes are kind of humped up. There's a stream coming in, and you can see where it's breaking up the ice, but it's attached to the bottom around the sides. And here the ice is completely under the water. You see all those holes in the ice. When that ice finally lets go, it all lets go at once. The buoyancy overcomes the attraction to the bottom, or the cementation at the bottom. It lets go at once. Water jets through those holes like in a vortex, and you end up with where there's soft bottoms, you end up with this sort of thing here, where I'm going into this crater here. It looks like a moon underneath the water, so clear. It's just like there's no water there at all. And raised rims, it just look like craters of the moon. And that's a feature that was described in literature before I was up here, but it was described in the ocean, in the Arctic Ocean, and it was thought to be related to tide lifting the ice up and down. But in this case, it's very common in lakes. They're called strudel holes because they look like strudel, I guess. The other feature, there's 15 million lakes in Canada, and I'll bet a quarter of them are in this environment. And every one that has this glacial mud around the side has these patterns, which I wrote a paper on, called them ribbon trough features. And for some reason, there's just virtually no literature on this. It's one of the most common features in lakes, although it's all up north, one of the most common features in lakes in North America. And they're related to the same process that forms mud boils. Here you can see this is from about 100 feet up, looking down on some of these things. You can see on the shore there are mud boils, and offshore there are these features. And you can see often where a lake level drops, these features begin to become circular. So they're related somehow to the same processes you see on land. And I think they extend usually down to about 2 meters, which, as I said, is the average depth of ice. So I think that probably it has something to do with the progressive freezing onto the bottom of ice in the winter. Another thing, I pointed out that most of Nunavut is underlain by granitic rocks with acidic soils. There are little patches of limestone here and there that are preserved and haven't been eroded away. And when you find these, you find that the vegetation is very limited. Most plants in the tundra are very acid-loving plants, and they can't take this alkalinity. And it's so strong that here's just a boulder of dolomite. It's a magnesium-rich limestone, which you hardly ever see. There's very limited outcrops of it. Sitting there, the glaciers carry it from an outcrop and dumped it there, and just the water running off of that boulder has killed all the vegetation around it. It's a kill zone. It's a very amazing sensitivity of the ecosystem to just little changes in chemistry. And these features, I just threw these in because they're neat. They're like little pingos. I don't know if you know what a pingo is, but they're sort of ice blisters that have worked their way up under a sand cover in the Magoose River Delta near Hudson Bay. And so they're sandy. They're all completely, because it's almost on the tidal flat, there's a lot of seabirds in this area, and each one of those things is full of Arctic fox dens. And when you walk among them, it smells because they've dragged all these carcasses in, and air wafts out of the holes, and they're barking. I mean, just it's the weirdest sensation. It's just otherworldly. It should be an international biological site because it is so incredibly unique, but probably won't be. And the last thing I'm going to talk a little bit about caribou. The Kaminuriac caribou herd, which varies from under 50,000 individuals to over 100,000, and I don't think anybody knows exactly why it fluctuates that way, is all through this area, particularly in that area. I was talking about the red till earlier, and I'm going to show you how I think that's related. Caribou make an awful mess of the tundra. There are these trails all over the place. Because of that, the nature of the terrain, they just don't go away. They'll persist forever. And here you can see where they've been walking along the slopes of a gravel deposit in western Nunavut, and they form these little terraces. And some geologists have mistaken those terraces for geological features and diverted some considerable amount of mineral exploration money into following up on something they thought they indicated. But they're caribou trails. A lot of that terrain is like this. This is a huge granite boulder terrain that is just basically impassable to people and to caribou. So how do people and caribou get around there? Well, the eskers that I was talking about, we looked at the pictures of them forming on Violet Island. There are eskers all over Nunavut and in that terrain west of Hudson Bay and east of Hudson Bay as well. They become... There's an example of one that's about 150 feet high. There's another one that's is bifurcated into several ridges. And there's one that's been, as it's been lifted up through the sea. Remember, I talked about the isostatic rebound of the land after the weight of glaciers had been removed. You see beaches cut into it. Those become transportation corridors for people. When you walk along them, you see all kinds of human-related stuff, or anything from graves to meat caches. But you can see on this one that the lichen has been worn off. Caribou follow those as well. And I've seen caribou running full tilt up and down one of those just to get away from the bugs, because they're high and the wind blows the bugs off of them up there. This is just a very small part of the Kaminuriac caribou herd. It's an amazing sight to see these animals congregated. They're not just scattered around up there. They're all in one big herd. The red till, when this is a fresh, I made a fresh exposure here with a pump, and about a couple of days later, because it's so arid, the surface got encrusted with this white stuff, which is salt. And that red till, wherever it's exposed freshly at the surface, gets encrusted with salt. And here's a mud boil. Here's one of these diapirs that I showed you earlier. That actually is the original trace. And Steve told me it looked like a face, which I've seen this millions of times. I never thought it looked like a face, but it does, kind of, in profile. Anyway, that's all covered with salt. And if you look at the distribution of caribou, this is a map I made when we were doing the sampling to try to map where the red till was, because it has an effect on how you interpret the geochemistry that we were doing. And this is if you look, what am I doing? I'm covering that up. Right there is Baker Lake. These are not the same scale, obviously. And there's Baker Lake on that slide. These little circles here are 32 years of calving, where the center of the calving grounds were for the Kaminuriac caribou herd. They go up here to calve in the summer, and then they wander back south again into the boreal forest in the winter. And I am convinced, I may be wrong, but I'm convinced that the reason that they go to the same place every year is because there's salt to lick, and it's also there are not many boulders on the surface. And these are Inukshuks, and the translation of that is ersatz people. And I actually didn't know when I put this up, Steve pointed out to me today, there's actually some real people in there. That's a real person and that's a real person, but most of these are cake cairns. You see these all over the tundra. They're put up to as signposts for communication. They're put up to guide people to caribou harvesting grounds. And I think one of the reasons they're put up is just so you feel like there's something. Thank you.